Hi, Wendell.
Hi, Bob.
How are you?
Doing well.
Good. Let me introduce us. I'm Robert Wright. This is The Wright Show. You are Wendell Wallach, and you are a scholar at Yale University's Interdisciplinary Center for Bioethics.
That's
You've also written about technology more broadly. Your latest book, published in 2015, is called A Dangerous Master: How to Keep Technology from Slipping Beyond Our Control, published by Basic Books. And a few years earlier, you co-authored a book called Moral Machines: Teaching Robots Right from Wrong. And we're going to talk about whether technology is out of control, or if it's getting out of control, how to keep it from doing that. And, whether, how concerned we should be about bad things technologies can do. I would say that your view is, I don't know if you, I wouldn't necessarily call you a techno-pessimist, but I would say on balance, you're more cautionary than celebratory about technology. Is that fair to say?
Well, yes and no. I mean, I do sometimes, as an ethicist, I'm seen as being a naysayer, but that's not my view at all. I just want us to attend to the risks and negative societal impacts while we're trying to maximize the benefits. And there's so many other people who are celebratory. My job is more or less to underscore what requires our attention.
Now, if somebody did want to make the case that you're a Luddite, I saw a little item on your resume that they might point to. Do you know what I'm thinking of?
An item on my resume that might make me seem in light. No, I don't know what you're
It says that
thinking.
you designed stained glass windows. That's a very old technology.
Oh yes, that's about as old as they go, or at least not the oldest, but we're getting back there. Yeah.
How did you wind up in designing stained glass windows?
Well, I just love the qualities of light, and I'm very fascinated by the nature of light and energy movements and so forth. And as it turned out, my father, who was an overly busy doctor at Christmas time, he would make these stained glass windows out of colored cellophane and black Mystic tape, and he would reproduce some window from Chartres or one of the other great cathedrals. So we had like four or five of these that we were able to put up on picture windows in our home every Christmas. So I think I got the bug from him, or at
I
least
see.
picked that on from him.
I see. Okay. But as for more recently developed technologies, there's a lot we could talk about, and we're going to try to talk about as much as possible, ranging from killer robots to, the basement engineering of bioweapons. And then there are more kind of mundane things that are clearly already with us. I know you're concerned about what John Maynard Keynes called technological
Unemployment.
unemployment, and in a way, this was an election issue because the some of the discontents in middle America that are said to have helped get Donald Trump elected had to do with unemployment, which Trump tended to blame on immigration. I think a lot of economists will tell you that actually, at least as big a force has been technological change, right?
Right. And it's not just unemployment, but it's also that real wages have either stagnated or declined, depending on how you look at it, for goods producing workers over the last 35 years in America. And it actually goes into 50 years in some of the European countries.
And of course, the traditional argument of economists who are defending the market system has been that, well, yes, in the short run, there's some displacement of workers, but on balance, technology creates more jobs than it eliminates.
So this is a debate that those of us who are trying to say it's different this time encounter the most, because for 200 years there have been fears that each new technology will displace more jobs than it will create, and that hasn't happened for 200 years. So the backward-looking economists say, well, that hasn't happened for 200 years. This time is no different. Those like myself who argue that, no, it is different, try and push on the fact that, for example, artificial intelligence is replacing more and more cognitive jobs and more jobs that require cognitive skills. And we've got some very interesting evaluations about what percentage of existing jobs could be automated with present-day technology, not to even talk about forms of artificial intelligence that might appear over the next decade or two. So that doesn't necessarily tell us how many new jobs will be created, but it gives us a sense that there's a vast vulnerability out there. Osborne and Frey said 47% of jobs in America were vulnerable. Their methodology being applied to India was 69% of jobs, China 75% of jobs, and Europe in the mid-50s.
What kinds of jobs are these that, say, in the United States in particular, are vulnerable to, you're saying existing technologies, right?
To existing or very near-term technologies. Now, I think all of these figures are high because they do include jobs like waitresses, that I think actually there's more to the job than just delivering food, but people may go to a fast food restaurant where robots or automation serves them, at least for the fun of it. I'm not sure that will replace all of our waitresses. But other jobs are ones that have traditionally required human skills. So paralegals are starting to become a slowly endangered profession.
And that's partly, I gather, because of pretty mundane, what seem now like mundane technologies, like just search for documents, right? I mean, they used to, humans used to spend a lot of time just searching for documents relevant to a given case without the benefit of computers. And obviously, if you have computers to help you, you need fewer paralegals.
So as more and more cities and municipalities, for example, put their titles online, the records of who owned what properties when, doing a title search is really a piece of cake compared to what it used to be a mere 10 years
ago.
Well,
I've got to say, I have long wondered why this title search, when you buy a piece of real estate, is such a big industry. I've always thought, like, wait a sec. I mean, even before computers, I just thought, like, why don't we have a system where, you know, you have the official deed, it's at City Hall. So I've never understood why it was that there could be lurking out there all of these issues affecting the legality of your ownership of a piece of property that you don't know about. We needn't get into that. But anyway, part of me is glad to hear that we're streamlining that process.
And there's an awful lot of these jobs that it's wonderful that we're streamlining. I have friends who have started robotic companies where the robots are carrying boxes off of one shelf and loading them onto trucks. On one level, this seems like inhuman work that it's great that we have robots doing. On the other hand, it is taking a lot of jobs. There's estimates of perhaps more than 100 million workers worldwide doing jobs like that.
Yeah.
So that's a big chunk of workers whose jobs no longer exist if we roboticize, warehouse packing and shipping.
Right. And you know, even that may seem kind of mundane to people, but that involves a kind of artificial intelligence in the sense that it involves, you know, perceptual abilities and visual discrimination and sometimes rudimentary forms of judgment. That, right. It's funny, one of Trump's economic advisors, a prominent one, was recently quoted as saying, oh, as far as artificial intelligence endangering jobs, that's way down the road. And I thought, well, wait a second, I think we're kind of there. I mean, just look at, like, truck drivers. I mean, traditionally you would have thought only a human being could drive a truck because you have to have a certain degree of cognitive discernment. And I think in 5 years, isn't it possible that in 5 years we will have seen really significant displacement of truck drivers by self-driving trucks?
Well, yes and no. I mean, when we get into the self-driving universe, there's a lot of different complications that come into play. So we could see displacement of self-driving trucks because there's a good number of prototypes that have been developed already. And most trucking is just going from point A to B on a highway. Mm-hmm. But the self-driving technology is still problematic as soon as you get off of highways. And it's not truly ready for prime time, regardless of the way it gets hyped in the industry. The other part of this is you're talking about you're talking about either producing new trucks, which are remarkably expensive, or retrofitting existing trucks with the software, the sensors, the other things they will need to be self-driving. So that's probably going to come relatively slowly or relatively quickly, depending on your point of view. But then you also get into the political dynamics. What will truck drivers do when they see their jobs being displaced? I would expect we're going to see incidences in France or the US or other countries where truck drivers suddenly decide they're just going to put their trucks across highways and close them down.
Well, the word Luddite comes from a previous episode of Resistance to Technological Change, right? I don't know the details. Or is this mythic, or did it really happen, the Luddite thing?
It really happened, but it's not clear whether Ned Ludd, exists. Who this was named after. So it was a rebellion by weavers in England.
By what? By
weavers.
Weavers. Okay.
Weavers in England, and I think it was Nottingham or Nottinghamshire, that section of England, when the Jacquard looms came along, and they basically created a method of setting up the pattern and not having to think about it in advance. So this started to automate weaving. We do know that they destroyed some of the equipment. The movement got named after Ned Ludd, an earlier figure who's said to rebel. But whether Ned Ludd truly existed or not, that's one of these historical controversies that has not been fully settled, to my knowledge.
Okay. Now, if we try to think of like other jobs that are not currently in obvious danger but might be, like what are some ones that might be closer to a real threat than we think? I mean, for example, I would have thought like 15 years ago, 20 years ago, like journalism, which I've spent a lot of my life doing, would be pretty safe. But they actually now, I think, you know, when it comes to writing just elementary business stories, like taking a quarterly financial report that a company has released and turning it into a basic 3-4 paragraph story, I think some of that's being done through automation. And so who should feel threatened here in the most immediately?
Well, I think everybody should feel threatened a little bit, and let me say why. But I mean, first, there are some professions that are going to disappear quicker than others. Google has come up with a new translation program that was usually the translation systems were trained using this new deep learning technique, which isn't unstructured learning, but it's a kind of structured learning that can do certain tasks very well. And that is so accurate that people will only need translators for very sophisticated tasks, or when they need very exacting or legal understanding of the documents they're looking at. So that's something that's disappeared. But I wanted to use that to take us into what's taking place, which is there are more and more of these cognitive tasks that can be managed very well or handled very well by computational systems. And whereby that might not eliminate a full job, it eliminates a significant portion of a job. And that is the immediate threat, that suddenly you have more and more workers, as we already saw with word processors and other technologies, we have more and more workers who are, it's not that they aren't necessary, it's just that fewer of them are needed. So you will still have professions to do those tasks that cannot be automated. On the other hand, the overall number of people being employed in those fields will go down dramatically. And that's what we're going to see in almost every conceivable field.
Well, paralegal, which we talked about, is an example of that, right?
Right.
So, like with doctors, preliminary diagnosis, presumably. Given the natural language capabilities we're seeing with things like Siri and Google Home or whatever, I would imagine it's pretty near term that when I have a problem I want to see a doctor for, the first step is not to go into the doctor's office. It's just to describe the thing to my computer and let the computer take a picture of any part of me that's relevant. And even that cuts down on the amount of time, a certain amount of the preliminary diagnosis is presumably done by machine.
That actually has a lot of different dimensions to it that might surprise you. Interestingly enough, the act of asking the right questions and knowing what tests to ask for, that's actually something that we will need the doctors for. That may be the task that we'll need them for, or the paralegals, and that also has an interpersonal dynamic that at least the better doctors are able to draw out from you things you might not say otherwise, or know in a layered way what to ask you mm-hmm. about. But once we have that information, we're already in a situation that for many conditions, the software is a better diagnostician than most doctors. Mm-hmm. And that's something we're in the midst of already. So it's this question of whose diagnosis should be relied upon. Mm-hmm. Now, at this time, it's still the human, there's still the recognition that turning over all of these tasks to software is not appropriate and may be making assumptions that we should not be making. But when you think that we are in a litigious society, doctors may feel very uncomfortable about going against a software diagnosis, particularly when there's that when you have the trail that basically the computer said do this, and the audit trail that the computer said one thing and the doctor overrode what the computer said. So artificial intelligence in and of itself is becoming a major restructure of what healthcare will be in the coming years. And indeed, one of my affiliations that you didn't mention is I'm a senior advisor to the Hastings Center, which has been the first bioethics think tank and has been around for more than 50 years now. And we have started a project to look much more closely at what is the impact of AI on healthcare and what issues need to be thought through and resolved.
Okay. So if you look at it at the other side of the coin, not like which jobs will be endangered when, but like which jobs could you expect to persist even as automation proceeds, can you imagine is really getting to a point where actually the only jobs are writing the software, right? That would be the extreme scenario.
Oh, a lot of the software gets written by computers now.
So it's even worse. It's even worse than I suggested then.
No, but I mean, I'm among those who believe that the kinds of cognitive capabilities we're talking about, maybe intelligence in the sense that we talk about, let's say, an IQ test being intelligence, but there's still a long way from wisdom. There's still a long way from an intrinsic understanding by the machine of the activity that it's performing. Mm-hmm. So there's still a lot of room for creative tasks, for problem solvers. There's an array of capabilities that I don't see being solved yet by artificial intelligence. So there's no shortage of people who would like to believe that because humans, in a sense, are biological machines, that we can get the functional equivalent out of computational machines. My own sense is that's a pretty simplistic view, and even if it turns out to be true, it's going to take longer than is often projected.
Okay. So let's talk about some specific areas. I mean, I mentioned killer robots, and this has been a concern of yours. I gather. In other words, somewhat autonomous weapon systems. Now, where do you start getting concerned? Drones seem largely human controlled. They don't seem to have anything very much like volition.
They're still totally human controlled, right, in terms of the fundamental tasks they perform. What gets more and more automated is how they do certain things. You know, how they land, for example, or take off, that can be increasingly automated. How they fly over long distances that are unproblematic. It's like the present state of self-driving cars. Mm-hmm. More and more of that can be automated, but the decision-making still lies with the human. The discrimination over what's being looked at, that lies with humans. And in fact, at least in the military context, you have a good number of people standing behind the drone, including experts in international humanitarian law, the laws of armed conflict that we have more or less agreed upon internationally as a standard for how war should be conducted, and particularly how you protect non-combatants. Mm-hmm. So at least at this stage, these are hardly semi-autonomous systems. The concern comes as these systems are able to move into the area of selecting targets and dispatching people or targets, which could be a building or could be something much larger than that, without any real-time intervention of people at all. Or if there are people, they are people what is called on the loop, meaning they're perhaps managing a good number of these drones, and therefore, given the accelerating speed of conflict, have little idea what most of them are doing. They're just sort of there in case something really weird happens. So that's what the movement to ban is. And most people think of that in terms of drones that have facial recognition software and therefore could pick out a target and, you know, kill a specific person. But what I emphasize over and over again is lethal autonomy is not a weapon system. It's a feature set that could be added to any weapon system. And therefore, when you suddenly start thinking about adding this feature set onto a weapon system that directs a high-powered munition or even a nuclear weapon, mm-hmm, this is not something we should want in any way, shape, or form.
Okay, let's take a recent example. So there was a big story about large-scale civilian death in, I guess it was it Iraq or Syria? It was Iraq because I think it was in Mosul. I think at least 100 civilians were killed. And the situation was that there were apparently enemies, you know, ISIS people on top of the building, as I understand it. And,
right.
And so we bombed and the building collapsed and all the people died. And now I started wondering, like, well, what if you had a drone that you could send in and say, here's the building, kill the people you see on top of it? That's one level of refinement. Another level of refinement is look for people who fit a certain description, like wear the kinds of things ISIS fighters wear and so on. Like, have I already gotten to a point where you get concerned?
Yes and no. See, I'm not concerned that those capabilities will get built into drones. Mm-hmm. And the advantage of drones in general has been that they've actually increased the degree of selectivity. They're much more, considering that there are sensors and cameras on these, the people who actually dispatch the weaponry from the drones, they are able to make discriminating decisions about whether they think the weapon should be deployed or not. Mm-hmm. And so my point is not that we shouldn't be using this technology. I would just like to have a human still engaged in the loop who, in effect, gives the go-ahead, or is there at least where there's a second notice or something if the drone says, I've got a match between a face and a person. You know, it's, it shouldn't. I don't think the idea of making this indiscriminate is healthy for a lot of reasons, largely because of how it will escalate over time and how it opens the door to lowering the barriers to starting new wars or even starting unintentional wars or even flash wars where tens of thousands of people could be killed in a few minutes before it was realized that our drones, you know, came up against their drones and somebody made a mistake and suddenly we were exchanging fire.
Of course, one, you know, you can imagine getting to the point where, as with the case that you mentioned in the context of medicine, where software is in some cases more reliable than doctors, you can imagine the case where targeting mistakes are less common when the decision is made entirely by software. I mean, when you look at the kinds of things that are used to decide whether someone is likely a militant, they're basically algorithms, right? It's like, they're, you know, it's all young males, it's this, you know, they're wearing this, they're coming out of a mosque that's known for, you know, I mean, these are the kinds of things that our people have used in the past, at least. They're things you could program into software, right?
Yes and no. I mean, you could up to a point. We haven't got, you know, effective systems for that right now. The difficulty is whether there will be adequate situational awareness in these. I mean, right now we don't have humans who are always taking into account the whole context. But the other difficulty is what this leads to as it escalates. We already have a pace of war that is getting to be faster than human response time. And this just exacerbates it to the point where you no longer have humans even engaged in significant decision making. So the long-term consequences could far outweigh any short-term benefits that you get from this technology. The other aspect of it is that even if you can show reliability in individual circumstances, will that be outweighed by unpredictable events that will occur when you defer these decisions to the machines themselves? So you're talking about complex adaptive systems functioning in very complex, what are referred to as socio-technical environments, where they're humans and different interactions and different forces in play. And these systems are going to do unpredictable things or things you would not intended them to do. There may even be emergent properties coming out of them, and none of us know where that will take us. And I'm not talking about systems that have a high degree of intelligence. I'm talking about what we are likely to see in the next 5, 10, 15 years.
So I guess it's kind of like on Wall Street. I mean, as long ago as the 1980s, I think, there was a big crash that was attributed at least partly to automated trading. Right. And no one had anticipated that. No one had looked at the programs that were being used and thought, oh, wait, they could start feeding on themselves. And in a similar fashion, I guess you're saying there could be like positive feedback between two sides in a war that are relying on automation that just isn't anticipated and gets out of control.
Right. I mean, that's the flash war scenario that I believe Stuart Russell was the first one to put forward. But that you can conceive of that happening. And I would say it's not even conceiving of it. It is what's traditionally known as a low probability, high impact event. It's a gray swan now that we have recognized that it's a possibility. But the fact is these events will occur. Mm-hmm. And they not only will occur, but they could lead to massive violations of international humanitarian law, particularly in the loss of large numbers of non-combatants.
Right.
So that means these systems have the potential to violate the laws of armed conflict, which are really about the only kind of normative force we have in the world to tame the outrages of warfare.
And I think there have actually even been cases in the annals of near nuclear war, you know, cases where, something could have gone wrong. Have there been times when somebody just said, you know, the rule book tells me I should launch, but this just seems a little too weird to me? Or, you know, it's like, I don't, the alarming data that's coming in, I'm just not going to trust, right? I mean, have there been cases where humans just said, basically, I'm not going to play by the rules? And of course, computers, one thing they never say is, I'm not going to play by the rules.
Yeah, there are actually famous cases, one with a Russian general. But I mean, you can think, it's just slipped my mind what that case was at the moment. Another one, of course, is when you think of the Kennedys during the Bay of Pigs. Right. If there had not been their resistance and they had not been in that position, the basic logic that was being brought to them by their leaders was that they should be striking Cuba. And when we start talking about automation, automation is going to be that kind of logic. It's not going to be the discrimination. It's not going to be the person who says, well, let's look at this a little bit deeper, and maybe, well, do we have a sensor on that corner over there? Perhaps we should look at that corner before we dispatch this weaponry. And who knows, maybe there's a bunch of children or a school there. It's that kind of thing that you still want to have. And of course, we're asking for discriminating human beings, not, you know, not just those who are mechanically also following procedures, but it's that kind of awareness, wisdom, experience that you want to make sure is part of the decision-making process, particularly when you're entering into a situation where you can start a new war or unintentionally expand an existing conflict.
But the funny thing is, not hilarious, but ironic, is that you could argue that in nuclear war, there's actually a kind of incentive to automate the thing. What I mean is this, that, you know, nuclear weapons exist in the context of what's called deterrence theory. And the idea is that once you both have nuclear weapons, the way you keep war from breaking out is to credibly insist that if they launch, you will launch, right? And the way to make that most credible would be to say, look, we have turned this over to machines. We can guarantee you that if we see this data that we've got incoming missiles, you are toast. So there's actually an odd kind of logic behind automating it, which, as you suggest, could be a big mistake.
Well, this is the movie Dr. Strangelove, you know, the classic, where in effect that's what happened. The doomsday machine was turned on.
But is that right? Was that, I mean, I watched that a long time ago. Was that actually an automated decision?
Well, they didn't get into the technology of it so much as just saying that once they had, you know, that it was the response to a first strike. Mm-hmm. So it seems like it was automated. Mm-hmm. I don't know that they went into the details. So in that case, you know, it did no good if they hadn't told the Americans that was the case, but it still didn't save anybody against the psychopath who actually wanted to drop the nuclear weapon on Russia. So I think that's the other problem we're getting into. Mistakes happen. Mistakes happen with technology, they happen with people. Do you really want all of this automated? And do you want it automated at a speed where humans don't even get a chance to intervene? Do we turn over the future of humanity to decisions that machines make? Or is this still going to be a human-centric world where we at least have some say in our destiny? So I, as well as you, know that there is this logic. I mean, Jonathan Schell did a wonderful book, The Fate of the Earth, where he went through the logic of first strike and nuclear capabilities and so forth, and showed that how convoluted but intrinsically bizarre and insane it is. And yet it does have a logic of its own. Mm-hmm. I just question whether that's the kind of logic we want to invest our destiny in. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I don't question it. I mean, I just think it truly violates the laws of international human. It truly violates international humanitarian law.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And really, all we're asking for is it becomes explicit within international humanitarian law. Now, that said, to make robots explicit is not easy. There will be violations. It'll be hard to prove when it was an autonomous weapon system and when it wasn't. But this isn't something we should just let get out of hand.
So you're suggesting what, an international treaty prohibiting the automation of certain kinds of weapons?
Yeah, at the very least, high munitions weapons, but I think it can go well beyond that. In fact, I have an article coming out on this actually next month in the communications of the ACM
what does ACM stand for?
Oh, something
about computing machinery, or
It's not that I'm proposing it. Many people are proposing it. The Convention on Certain Conventional Weapons, which is a totally misnamed treaty, but basically they oversee arms control. They function out of the UN in Geneva. They had 3 years of hearings with experts. I'm one of the experts who testified there. They've now bumped that up to a next level to try and forge a treaty that perhaps could be voted on, but most people believe, at least at this stage, it's bumped up another level to die. So we're going to need an event or a reactivation of public interest to really get anything passed, any forms of international arms control agreement passed.
Okay. Now, so far we've been talking about the kinds of weapons that you can imagine being regulated in principle by treaty in a fairly straightforward way, because these are the kinds of weapon systems that governments produce. Like, you know, certainly if you've got like ballistic missiles and so on. But when you move to biotechnology, the most commonly expressed fear is actually that terrorists will use these, right? That increasingly we're seeing very sophisticated technologies for manipulating the genes of microorganisms and so on that, for all I know, exist in the basement in the house next door to me, right? This is a different kind of threat.
This is a different kind of threat. And just to give you a sense of how quickly all this is moving, so Moral Machines A Dangerous Master was published a little more than a year and a half ago. I did not even mention CRISPR-Cas9, this new gene editing technique.
That's CRISPR, which stands for something or other.
Right. And it's not, there are other CRISPRs. There's other, not just the Cas9, but the point is, these new techniques that have not only sped up gene editing, but they're basically putting them in the hands of almost anyone. That doesn't mean that anyone can necessarily create, let's say, an effective bioweapon any more so than we can effectively, you know, fully clone a new human being through these techniques. But it's just made it much easier to change a chromosome. And I know not only of graduate students who do this and say it's quite easy, but I've heard of high school students who've done it under supervision.
Now, and what is what kind of equipment do they need, and how hard is it to get?
Not hard to get. They don't need a lot of equipment, and the gene snippets that they use can often be bought by mail order. There's this new catalog coming out of synthetic biology, which is in the hopes that people will create new biological products. And they are. They're creating all kinds of things, biological sensors, different. There are these competitions that young people are brought together at MIT every year in different teams and asked to produce something, and they find their way with these off-the-shelf snips of DNA, and they assemble something that has a kind of biological function. So this do-it-yourself biology is becoming comparable to what it was to, I don't know, build your own radio in the 1950s.
So if you ask what would it take to take some kind of pathogen, some kind of microorganism, and turn it into something a little new that is lethal in such a new way that we don't have an existing guard against it, and it's highly contagious, if you ask what it would take to create that, the answer is it would take stuff that's actually just readily available to any human being with sufficient knowledge? I mean, in terms of the equipment they would need and the raw material they would need, and, you know?
Well, they can get the, that's, I'm saying they can in effect mail order the equipment they need. They can mail order even a lot of the biological specimens that they need. So, yes, I mean, that's the do-it-yourself world we're moving into, where gene hacking is now in the hands of almost anyone.
I mean, shouldn't we be completely terrified by this?
Well, I mean, I'm trying to keep it a little less dramatic than that.
Well, convince me.
Yes, I mean, the prospects of biological weaponry. I mean, imagine if somebody just takes... Well, let me step back for a minute, okay? We are already looking at creating new species for health purposes. So we want mosquitoes that do not carry the Zika virus. And we actually have techniques for getting those that do carry the Zika virus quickly replaced by the species that won't. So this has made it very attractive. These are called gene drives. This has made it very attractive, let's say, to go down this route with mosquitoes that carry Zika. We have different mosquitoes that carry malaria. Perhaps locusts that swarm is something we would like to replace because of all the farming damage, all the agricultural damage they do. But when you think that locusts that swarm in 47 different countries, you're talking about potentially changing ecosystems, you know, all over, with very little knowledge about what that means, let alone introducing a new species that could totally upset an ecosystem because it does not have a fundamental characteristic that was necessary. So we are developing these technologies that can be vastly beneficial, but now you think of somebody who actually figures out how in the lab to create swine flu or bird flu in a way where it can pass more easily from animal to human or between human. Suddenly you have a global pandemic on your hands.
Right. That's why I say we should be terrified. Because it only takes one deranged, smart, highly motivated person, right?
Right.
That's, you know... Whereas traditionally, it's taken more than that to kill hundreds of thousands or millions of people.
So, like in the book, A Dangerous Master, which is largely a primer on what the emerging technologies are, talking a little bit about the benefits, but largely what goes wrong. At a particular point, I pivot then and say, okay, how do we address these challenges? How do we address it? Through technology, through challenging certain assumptions that have blinded us to what we're dealing with? How do we change it through corporate oversight? How do we change it through new forms of agile governance? Presently, we have a total mismatch between these technologies that are coming at a fast and furious rate. We have what is sometimes referred to as a pacing gap between the speed at which they're appearing and their legal, ethical oversight. And this is something we need to almost rethink government or governance. I don't like government because I think that focuses on hard law and regulation. But we need to rethink governance or the oversight of these technologies if we want to at least mitigate, perhaps not totally stop, but mitigate the potential harms these technologies could affect while we are trying to maximize the benefits that they're being developed for.
So let me, I've thought a little about this just in a kind of amateur way and things you could do. Let me throw out one possible kind of remedial law you can imagine, and let me just see what you think of it. And of course, ultimately, this would have to be international. It would have to be, you know, you'd have to get all countries to agree to implement the law themselves. Because we live in a world where disease can spread across borders and so on. But if you imagine a law where certain kinds of laboratory equipment, like the kinds that can do this CRISPR editing, the law is they have to have self-monitoring stuff and maybe even report instantaneously, you know, up to the cloud or something. They have to report what they're doing, you know, what is being done with them, what genetic manipulation is being performed. And you would have to say that possession of a machine that does not automatically do that in this airtight way is illegal, right? Mm-hmm. So it seems to me that you have to start thinking of that sounds pretty draconian, probably. I don't know. Certainly, if you demanded comparable oversight in the realm of conventional weapons, guns, you'd have a world of political trouble on your hands in the United States. But I mean, isn't it the case that you need something that's at least that interventionist?
Yes, I mean, but it, you know, whether you can really pull that off is the question. You know, you aren't talking,
you mean politically or.
I mean, you aren't talking about like centrifuges, for example.
Right, that's the problem. They're not these. That's why I say the very possession of things that don't have these properties would have to be illegal. You just can't. You obviously can't monitor in the absence of a rule like this. There's no way to keep track of the use, right? Unless self-monitoring and automatically reporting devices are the only kind of devices that it's legal to have. And if you're found with one that doesn't have these properties, or found with one whose reporting device has been disabled, you go to jail, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what I'm imagining. And it's hard for me to imagine something short of that that's up to the task.
Well, it's also whether that's up to the task.
No.
You know, I think that's the difficulty here. That gives you a means to prosecute the wrongdoers once you have found the wrongdoers. But, you know, it's not all that difficult to disenable that kind of capacity.
Well, it depends. I mean, you could say, look, the only kind that's legal to have is this kind where the monitoring is really deeply engineered. So it's really not that easy to, you have to, you know, whatever. I don't know enough technology. Well, anyway, let me just ask you this. Are you aware of proposals that do seem up to the challenge?
Well, there are proposals that seem up to the challenge if you're focusing largely on the good actors who don't want something to go awry. So you may remember a few years ago, DuPont bought DuPont or Monsanto, I keep getting it confused. I believe it's DuPont bought a company that had a gene that it could build into all of their new seeds that was called a suicide gene. It would ensure that the plant could not reproduce. Well, there was an uprising against that. And the uprising was largely about that they were doing this so they could sell you seeds year in and year out. So this was a form of exploitation. But you could look at this another way around, where that gene actually could ensure that, let's say, new crops didn't contaminate ancestral crops. So we do have proposals like that. We have proposals in nanotechnology where you could perhaps build in a component into these tiny little nanomachines that would dissolve with a known chemical reaction. You know, you could introduce some chemical and it would in effect destroy these little molecular machines.
Yeah, but that's a case where, this is what you're saying, is there's ways you can, when you're dealing with the good actors who are purchasing things legally and don't want to blow up the world, these are the kinds of things you can do. But as for the bad actors, are there any proposals that seem up to the challenge when you've got a situation where, again, one or two highly motivated, highly knowledgeable people can wreak massive havoc?
You don't have a way of absolutely stopping that. So what we're relying on at this point is largely, you know, the hopes of identifying those people, because often those people, you know, they are in labs, they are, you know, they're learning from each other, they're interacting with each other. So a few years ago, the FBI created a weapons of mass destruction counterterrorist unit that focused specifically on synthetic biology and nanotoxins. But one of their main vehicles was to go in and create a new relationship with the do-it-yourself biologists, the people in the labs, to sort of help them identify who might be problematic, where there was somebody else in your lab that was acting a little strange, and they were also engaged in ensuring those of us within academia that they would go in with a degree of sensitivity. And I actually think the people who founded this unit, they really did understand the problem and have their heart in the right place. So that was one of the means that was being introduced to try and track whether you had something problematic that was being developed or might be deployed. The other thing we see is taking place anyways, whereby the fear of, over the past decade, of new pathogens with bird flu and swine flu that could set in motion a global pandemic, had the World Health Authority dramatically upgrade the research facilities to look at whether there was an antidote or an inoculation, that a vaccination that could be developed to at least slow the progress. Though again, if you look at those in great depth, if we have a very fast moving pandemic, it'll wreak havoc long before this can be addressed.
Okay. Well, I think people are getting a sense for the kinds of perils that may be out there. And one, I mean, there's a couple of things you've already touched on that maybe we should just underscore. One is that you think the sheer pace of technological change is a big part of the challenge. Things change so fast that even when solutions are in principle findable and implementable, you just may not get them in time.
Right.
And here, you know, what seems to me troubling is that, although actually, you know, it's in some respects hard to quantify pace of technological change and compare pace, you know, but it seems to me that by and large, it is fair to say that the pace of technological change has tended to accelerate over time and is continuing to accelerate. And in fact, there are kind of techno-utopians, I guess, who believe that there's this singularity thing that lies ahead that's going to be this wonderful thing, and I've never understood why they think that as technological change moves faster and faster, it's going to lead to a glorious future. I'm more inclined to see your side of the argument that highly rapid technological change is a grave challenge, but in any event, does it seem to you to be the case that actually, yeah, it's things are moving faster and faster, and speed is part of the problem?
Speed's a big part of the problem. And a big part of the problem is we are not giving it appropriate attention. But I think that we're in a universe where perhaps there can be a shift in the speed, but the shift has to be on the deployment side of the new technology, not the development side. In other words, scientific discovery is going to continue at a rapid pace. There's very little we can do about that, or very little we could do without dramatically interfering with people's liberties. And nearly all of this research has a beneficial side. So it's always right. Going to be this trade-off between whether the benefits justify the risks and whether the risks can be mitigated. But it's that second part, I think, that we need to be much more focused on the mitigation of the risks before we allow the technologies to be deployed. And that's what I'm bringing up when I'm talking about bans on lethal autonomous weapons and some of the other ways in which I think the corporate sector could be more responsible. We could move more toward a dependence on soft governance, which is really corporate standards and insurance policies and laboratory practices and procedures, than hard governance, because there's no way legislators are going to either understand the breadth of issues coming up nor fund it. And there's too much of a reaction against overregulation. But if we're going to rely on these other kinds of mechanisms, whether they are technological solutions or corporate oversights, we need ways of punishing wrongdoers and we need ways of detecting wrongdoers.
Yeah, and you just touched on the other thing that I had was going to say we should underscore, which is just that the negative things grow out of positive things. And it's one reason that it's hard to stop the train even if you wanted to, because the bioweapons is just the flip side new medical interventions and so forth that people want. And of course, as you suggest, it's hard to stop the market from producing things that people want. Now, you might argue that in these realms, there is separately from what the market does, there is government subsidy in all these realms. But as a political matter, I think good luck making the argument that the National Institutes of Health shouldn't pursue the cures to disease, because that accelerates the rate at which problematic technologies will arise, right?
That's not going to happen. But I think if you could see that there was truly a problem that we had not figured out how to address from the political perspective, you could ask the National Institute from Health to at least put a moratorium on investing into that area, or invest in the safety side of that area. That's what's happened in AI recently, and that's what's sort of come out of the fears of superintelligence and so forth. Suddenly the AI community is looking much more closely at control algorithms, verification, testing regimes, a whole flock of technical problems that if they could be solved, then we have a possibility of going down these roads, and they are a little bit safer than they seem to be right now. But so far, the stress has been on producing the new functionality, and unfortunately, this gets us caught up in another conversation going on in all of our societies, is as long as technology is looked as the primary source of increased productivity, if not jobs, and technological unemployment raises a question of whether the jobs are really there, then you really have no recourse, or at least governments think they have no recourse other than to speed up the deployment of technologies. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have things like self-driving cars, where perhaps speeding up the deployment is a good idea. Self-driving cars right now are not ready for prime time. They will create accidents that attentive drivers would not create, and we haven't solved the kind of the social aspect of driving. What happens at a four-way stop sign? What happens when taxi drivers in a city are gaming the self-driving car or the trolley car problem-like thing? On the other hand, if self-driving cars truly are going to lower the accident rate dramatically, perhaps not as high as the 93% that gets thrown out, but even if it's only 50%, should we be speeding up the acceptance of that technology, even if we know that in some circumstances a self-driving car will kill somebody that an attentive driver would not?
Well, I think enough people have elderly relatives who are getting to a point where driving is problematic that you're actually going to see a fair amount of support for the deployment of this technology.
But to have the deployment, we should have the societal conversation that people fully understand. What are the benefits? Where are the risks? What are the trade-offs? Mm-hmm. And at least give tacit approval that we should not just surrender to the deployment of technologies without at least having tacit approval from the public, who has a fairly clear understanding of what they're approving.
Okay. Well, this has been fascinating. Thanks for taking the time. Also, I want to mention one thing I discovered before we started taping is that you and I have something in common. We're both meditators. You said you've been meditating for 50 years?
Yes, I'd say it's 50 years now, yeah.
And that's how you maintain your equanimity in the case of impending technological doom?
Well, I didn't get into meditation, looking at technological gloom, but I do think it helps maintain some equanimity. It's also part of my whole fascination with cognitive science and how the mind works and what mm-hmm. thoughts are and what they want and what they're doing. And it actually, I think, facilitates my ability to be as transdisciplinary as I am, to kind of, go into little corners that I don't understand, even if they're fearful. It does bring a little equanimity and a little sense that I'll be able to integrate even far-flung mm-hmm. ideas and insights as they arise.
Well, the other virtue of your meditation practice is that it gives me an opportunity to plug my forthcoming book.
Please do.
Which is called, modestly, Why Buddhism is True, and can be pre-ordered on Amazon. And once this goes up, once we post this and the podcast comes out, I will monitor Amazon to see if there's any impact. You know, Mike Kinsley, a former boss of mine, who was convinced that no one actually read books, once did a little experiment where he put cards in the middle of books that said, if you get this card, mail it to me and I'll send you whatever it was, $5 or $10. He says nobody mailed him, and that just proves that nobody reads books. Well, if there's no impact on my Amazon number, then that will just prove that no one actually gets to the end of these conversations, and that'll be sad. So I encourage people to cheer me up by pre-ordering. Also, they can rate the podcast, either the generic Meaning of Life TV feed or my feed, The Right Show, on iTunes. Even leave a positive or negative, as the case may be, review, and so on. And now it's your turn to plug things. We've got your book, A Dangerous Master, How to Keep Technology from Slipping Beyond Our Control.
Well, I mean, I have fascinating projects underway. One is perhaps a little similar to your book, which is, what is the dialogue between introspective practices, what we understand scientifically about scientifically about who we are? So I think it probably in some ways overlaps with some of what your book is, but that's far from being done. I have the main project I'm working on right now is to build global infrastructure to ensure that AI and robotics are beneficial. And that's really about trying to network the various groups that are jumping into that. And we already have alliances with the UN and the International Committee of the Red Cross, the World Economic Forum, the IEEE, other bodies. And we're networked to most of the players within that space. But the sad part is they're all so siloed that they don't even know each other at this stage of the game.
And is there somewhere online that people can go either to learn about this or to learn about other aspects of your work?
I do have a WendellWallach.com website. It hasn't been totally updated recently, but it makes it easy for you to get in touch with me. We are just putting together the website for the Building Global Infrastructure Project. It's not online yet, but it should be online within a week or so, and it's BGI4, the number 4, AI.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much. I think we need more people doing the kind of worrying that you do. So keep, in the meanwhile, until we recruit them, I want you to keep worrying. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay.
I'll do so.
Okay. Thanks, Wendell.